audio, and opinion anytime at freekeen.com. When you're planning your move to New Hampshire as part of the Free State Project, consider Keene, civil disobedience, politics, media, outreach, and social events. Keene has it all. Get connected with video, audio, our forum, and more at freekeen.com. That's freekeen.com.
It's the Onion.
Hey, Cindy.
Hello, good morning.
Okay, go ahead and count the five for me. Let me get a level.
1, 2, 3, 4, 5.
1, 2, 3, 4, 5.
1, 2, 3, 4, 5.
1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Okay, there, we're good. How are you?
I'm pretty good. How are you?
I'm, you know, it's, you know, the same battle. It never stops.
Yeah,
so
yeah, I know.
What we're going to do is I have no idea what you're doing now. I'm just now looking at your thing, and then we'll just kind of, you know, share and get all caught up with each other over the next hour and share it with the audience. It'll be fun.
Sounds good. Nice to talk to you again.
Yeah, I'm looking forward to this. I'm wondering how you. We just had Professor Boyle on, and you know, we're going to war, you know.
Mm-hmm.
And I'm just like, what are we going to do about it?
Again? Yeah.
It stopped. All right, here we go.
At theonion.com.
And now, live from the studios of Freedom's Phoenix, Ernest Hancock.
Believe me when I say we have a difficult time ahead of us. But if we are to be prepared for it, we must first shed our fear of it. I stand here without fear because I remember. I remember that I am here not because of the path that lies before me, but because of the path that lies behind me. I remember that for 100 years we have fought these machines. And after a century of war, I remember that which matters most. We are still here! Today, let us make them remember. We are not afraid!
Welcome back to Declare Your Independence with me, Ernest Hancock, here in Phoenix, Arizona, from beautiful studios. Freedoms with an S, freedomsphoenix.com. Check out freedomsphoenixezine.com. We tried to get, we're gonna see if we can get Cindy Sheehan to participate in future editions. When we, some subjects that I think could be near and dear to her. We certainly include stories about her on a regular basis on Freedom's Phoenix, and her travels and tribulations. But I want to make sure that we get caught up because Cindy and I have known each other for quite a while, and I've seen her activism develop and the influence that she's had. And she was, very influential. What America was waiting for at a certain time to be able to express their displeasure with the war and from the perspective of a mom. Now, one thing, and we'll get caught up over the hour. We're just going to relax and have a personal conversation here, and you guys get to share. So, Cindy, the first thing that came to mind is Donna put up some of the graphics and so on that we have here of your various activism that we're doing on the video stream. There's one of Al Sharpton hovering over you, embracing you or whatever. And you must have been sitting down because you're down to like mid chest and you're a tall woman. It makes it look like you're smaller than you normally are. And I'm going, that was one thing that really had an impact on me when I first met you and you were dealing with the press, is that as you'd be surrounded by the press, you were like a head taller than everybody, and you really dominated the conversation. You made sure that you were heard. Has that been an advantage to you dealing with the press?
Wait.
Had to push the button. Has that been an advantage to you?
Good morning, Ernie. Being tall, has it been an advantage?
I saw it as an enormous advantage. When you were in Camp Casey and you had, every single square foot of grass was covered with a satellite truck, there was an ocean of microphones and cameras, there was no bad place to be. Imagine you 5'4", it wouldn't have been the same. And
yeah.
It was
especially how flat Texas is too.
Really?
I guess it's an advantage. Yeah, I don't know. I'm almost 6 feet tall. I'm just a Scotian, just 6 feet tall, and that surprises a lot of people. Sometimes.
Oh, I thought you were even taller than that because it was. I saw the advantage, and it played out interestingly because you're very soft spoken. You get to the point. I got to tell the audience this one thing that I witnessed. There was, as we're at the intersection initially when we're sleeping in the ditches with the fire ants, there was on the other side of the road, there was a group of people come out. Yeah, we're for war and, you know, kill, 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 kill. And right. A lot of times the people, they may have lost a relative or a son or husband in the war, and they're wanting to kind of rationalize, justify it, and feel that, you know, they were against you and that there is a noble cause and they couldn't articulate it. But, you know, there was a good reason for the death of their son, didn't die in vain. And there was one father that I remember that you took aside, and you've probably done this many times, but you took him aside away from the cameras and everything just to have a private conversation with him. When you do that, as a mother that's lost a child in these useless wars, and you have someone on the other side that's protesting you, I would imagine that's a common occurrence that you take them aside and talk to them. What kind of conversation do you have?
Well, in the case of parents who have also lost their children, I try to give them a little bit more latitude than I give the average war supporter because, like you said, they have to... You know, I think maybe they have to believe that their child died for a noble cause just so they can get out of bed in the morning. And it's just a very difficult thing to be a grieving parent. So I just try to be rational with these people and say, you know, I give you the space to believe what you want to believe. I think it would be, you know, equally, you know, considerate if you would give me the same space to believe what I want to believe. And so I guess it's just like on a case-by-case basis. I remember also a pro-war veteran came out to Camp Casey, and he wanted to attack me on camera and get on camera, and he subsequently wrote a book. But anyway, I don't remember what his name is at all. And so he was like attacking me on camera, and I said, come on, buddy, let's just go talk away from the camera. I know you want to get your face on camera, but... let's have a little conversation. At the end of the conversation, he said, you know what, Cindy, I don't agree with you, but I love you, and I just want to tell you that if something happened to me, my mother would be doing the same thing you're doing.
Good, good. This you really humanized a lot of this for a lot of people where it was before, and the Bush administration and Cheney and Rumsfeld, all these guys, Fox News, were very, even see all of them, they were very successful in making this entire thing about colors and flags and explosions, and it was like a sporting event. And it was, you know, us versus them. It was us versus, you know, people with turbans and subsequently orange jumpsuits. And I could see the evolution when and I talk about it on the show often when it comes up, and I can use it as an example. My experience at Camp Casey was from a little bit different perspective than a lot of the other progressives that kind of rallied around the focus that you provided. And I could see what was happening. It was they were using and abusing you, and as much as you were trying to use and abuse them to get your message out, you kind of symbiotic there for a little while, but they wanted to make sure that they could get the entire anti-war movement under one hand, under in their fist, so that they could disband it, so that they could abandon it, so that they could get Obama in there, and it's no longer just get out and just leave like Dr. Paul did in 08. It was phased withdrawal and even expansion. And we could see it immediately after Camp Casey, I think is when they had the midterm election, and Pelosi came in, Speaker of the House, and the first thing they did was continue to fund the war.
Right.
And then you go, all right, well, where's the anti-war? And it goes for Obama, and he expands it. So I'm wondering, from your perspective, what happened to the anti-war movement? How was it dismantled? What did they do that you saw firsthand?
Well, you know, the difference between, like you said, that I use and abuse these people, the thing is, in the beginning of my quest, I thought that they believed the same thing that I did. I thought they wanted the same thing that I did. it took me a while, probably until after the midterm election, to realize that, you know, they didn't want the same things I did. They wanted just to get Democrats elected. And at first I thought that maybe that would help, that getting Democrats elected would help, because, you know, I wanted to believe that, I guess. I wanted to think that that our work was not going to be in vain. But I think the problem is that these organizations that came out to co-opt the anti-war message, my message, and to use the energy of the movement around Camp Casey, they just were, Democratic shills or people who were working for that. So the thing that happened to the anti-war movement was that it was co-opted by organizations like Move On, who were just pro-Democrat. They weren't anti-war. They were pro-Democrat.
Which is pro-war, just like everybody else. We'll get back more after the break, because this is an interesting history that you guys need to know. Because you get high enough up on the left side or the right side of the pyramid, at the top, it's the same people in charge of both. You know, and Move On, I saw it happen. And Cindy, you know, was taking advantage of it to get her message out, but finally she became aware and then ran against Pelosi.
This is Charles Goyette, author of the New York Times bestseller, The Dollar Meltdown, so you can learn how to protect yourself and your family. Now, you can audit the Fed, you can end the Fed, but why not start by ignoring the Fed? Visit DontTreadOnMeme.com. That's Don't Tread on M-E-M-E. Fashioning the Silver Economy, a meme, a contagious idea that spreads within a culture, a spontaneous order. Nowhere is this more evident than in one's free choice in that most marketable of commodities, money. Let us Austrians use wallet voting. Don't Tread on Meme, the leading craftsman of silver dime trading cards, as well as some offbeat liberty-themed apparel. Follow the history of the dime card outreach at onceuponadime.info. And get a silver calculator app at whatisthiscoinworth.info. Boycott an empire of theft. Build a society of consent. Don't tread on meme.
Agents of the state are threatening your freedom. Become a free agent and take it back. Google FR33 to get connected with other men and women around the globe who are united against state aggression and who are committed to not violent revolution, but peaceful evolution. It costs nothing to rally others to your causes by starting websites, creating and joining groups, and more. Stay up to date on the global movement for liberty by reading, watching, and listening to reports from our growing network of free agents. Free agents who work to achieve a free society can receive points for various activities, which can be redeemed for gear such as clothing, cameras, and more. When defending yourself against the state, be equipped with FR33 gear. You can directly invest in the projects you care about right now so that free agents can get the valuable support they need. States are going to fail. So,
hey, Cindy, when we come back and we talk about your show and stuff, we'll get all caught up in some other. Yeah, you heard Charles. Charles and I are still really good friends.
Oh, good.
He has a new book coming out. It's called Red and Blue and Broke All Over. His other book, The Dollar Meltdown, went New York Times bestseller, got translated into Chinese and Korean.
Wow. I think last time I saw him was in Phoenix when I was there to do a book signing a couple of years ago.
Yeah. No, I remember.
I think he told me about his book, yeah.
Well, it kicked butt, and his new one is just, you know, why freedom works and freedom good and government bad kind of thing. And it's coming out this next month, and it's going to be another New York Times bestseller you watch.
Tell
me, well, we'll talk about it on the air. You can tell me all about your show and so on. But I know, you know, what you're doing now. And we'll start with your realization and how they treated you and the anti-war movement and your run against Pelosi and your evolution and understanding Democratic, whatever. You know, so we'll start from there.
Okay, sounds good.
And.fm.
Since time began, tyrants have taken aim at personal liberties. Now there's a movie that aims back.
The government has no more right to tell us what to put in our bodies than they have to take our guns or tell us what books we can read.
Six drug police were eaten by bears while raiding a marijuana farm.
On your knees, you dirty hippies!
Jesus.
On your knees!
What's the problem, officer?
Today, many cops who enforce pot laws do so only because it provides them with cushy jobs, good benefits, and a chance to push people around.
I was an undercover narcotics officer. The drug war is nothing but a farce.
The Second Amendment says you gotta keep you and your gat intact.
Guns and Weed, The Road to Freedom. A film by Michael W. Dean and Nima Vadadi.
DVD available now at gunsandweed.com or on Amazon. That's gunsandweed.com. Makes the perfect gift. Remember, that's gunsandweed.com.
This is the Liberty Radio Network, broadcasting the latest liberty-oriented audio content 24 hours a day at lrn.fm.
To be a part of the show, call 602-264-2800. 602-264-2800. And now, Ernest Hancock.
Ernest Hancock. Oh, and we have Cindy Sheehan. She's just really demonstrated to a lot of people that very simple power. I remember it was probably 04, 05 when you first started doing your, it was Gold Star Families. And it was, it came to our attention when I was producing for Charles and we had you on. And at the time, I remember you were also being published on Lou Rockwell. And it became clear to me that at the very least you understood leave me alone libertarian philosophy. I mean, you kind of had hope in the progressive mindset of peace, and we're going to use that and I'll be a family and so on. But I'm wondering how over time, from our perspective, I understood that you understood and you were using the political process to try and provide your noble cause by finding out what the noble cause was that Bush told. Where did that come from? He actually physically in person said that to you, didn't he?
Well, you know, I can't say that I really understood a whole lot of stuff when Casey was killed. I was a, you know, just a normal, regular, whatever that means, band mom, scout mom here in Vacaville, just trying to make ends meet, doing the best I could for my family. But, you know, I considered myself a liberal Democrat, whatever that means. And now today I don't think there is really such a thing as that. And so my process I just had like a real steep learning curve in the school of hard knocks. And so I didn't learn by going to school. I learned by experiencing everything. And when my son was killed, when Casey was killed in 04, in April of 04, in June of 2004, we were invited to go meet with George Bush up in Fort Irwin, Washington State. And that meeting, by our perspective, didn't go very well. We felt, you know, that the president was very dismissive towards our grief. And, you know, if we dared question him, he got very defensive and everything. But we didn't question him as much as we should have. But we were still in deep, deep shock at that point. But, you know, when I heard George Bush say that, well, he told me that Casey died because he believes everybody deserves freedom. And even the people of Iraq, that's why what he told me. But then when I decided to go to Crawford in August of 2005, on April 3rd, George Bush said that our young people were dying for a noble cause. And nobody questioned him. Nobody in the media. He was at a press conference. Nobody actually asked him what the noble cause was. So I thought that I would go down to Texas and try to ask him what the noble cause was, since I got since I have a voice. So that's basically where that came from.
Well, go ahead. And from that time, as you know, you have, we have graphics up here of you speaking with Hugo Chavez You know, you're writing forewords in different books on different subjects. They use your name and your likeness and your notoriety to promote a lot of things from the left. And tell the people about your support or your collaboration with, or even the reason for meeting with Hugo Chavez. What brought that about?
Well, I'm not, I'm not making much sense today, but I don't think that there really is much of a left and a right. What is left? What is right in this country? I mean, they say that Hillary Clinton is a left-wing. People say that Barack Obama is a left-wing socialist, which is completely ridiculous. And, you know, I think that I do have a true left perspective on things. And Ernie, if you'll notice, the people that are that so-called left-wing people, I don't get published on those sites anymore. They don't publish my articles, the so-called left-wing sites. And, you know, it's because I have left that paradigm. I have left thinking that there's a difference between a Democrat and a Republican. I don't think that the solution lies in playing federal politics. And my recent book is called Revolution, A Love Story, and it's about Venezuela and about the Bolivarian Revolution that Hugo Chavez started in Venezuela. And it's not about a top-down change. It's about a grassroots bottom-up change, almost like the Occupy movement seemed to be going before they also got co-opted. The energy of that movement got co-opted.
That in and of itself is a powerful lesson that I think, you know, I've tried to share with the audience, and I think you're in a unique position to do that. Let's talk about that a little bit.
Okay.
As you were very much, and when I say you use and abuse and whatever, what I'm talking about is they offered you an enormous amount of resources, scheduling, giving you events, laying hands on Cindy to make sure you got press cards. Because they said, look, if you don't, as I remember, this is how it went down. I was there.
Uh-huh.
They go, if you don't stop saying immediate withdrawal and start inserting phased withdrawal, we're going to pull everything from you and you'll be a pariah and you won't have this stage anymore, Cindy. And you said, yeah, you know, bite me. Am I close?
Yeah, that's pretty much like I was. I mean, Move On sent their top heavy hitters to Camp Casey towards the end and said that they were going to push for a phased withdrawal. And if I didn't agree with the phase withdrawal, that I would lose their backing and their support.
So this, and then later, as you know, certainly Pelosi gets in there, the Democrats, and we made signs then. This is right at the beginning of the Ron Paul Levolution thing. While we're making signs, senior editor Pal Gamble made two signs. One, it's the Democrats' war now. And two, pin the war on the donkey. And I'm going, you know, that's so appropriate. And it really upset a lot of Democrats, but it was so true. And then it continued with Obama. So you eventually would run against Pelosi in San Francisco. Now, we're going to come up on the break here real quick, but when we come back, I definitely want to hear about that. And, you know, what kind of response did you get from the people there? Did they understand why you were doing it?
In San Francisco, this is another myth that San Francisco is extremely left-wing liberal. They're basically an establishment status quo, heavily Democrat city or district. And I eventually ended up, after the long, hard struggle that I'm still recovering from, getting 50,000 votes and coming in second place out of seven people. So, you know, there were at least 50,000 people there that understood what I was trying to do.
And Pelosi, was there any kind of impact you had on them? Can anybody have any impact on the political process? You know, that's a good place to kick off when we come back. You guys stay right there. You know, Cindy and I, you know, we've been frontline advocates for, you know, whatever our cause is, and certainly about some truth. And you're dealing in the political process. How do they control the message? How do they control the people, your supporters? How do they divide, conquer? You know, how do you make an impact in politics? Can you? Maybe not.
Do you feel like there's nothing you can do about the inexorable?
Okay, that's what we'll do when we come back, is political action, you know, the power of that or not, you know.
Okay.
Political action. And tell me about your show.
What do you mean, tell you about it now or tell you about it? When we get on there,
we'll talk about it when we get back. But I'm just, you know, I just want to know the basics. You know, are you just podcasting? Are you on daily?
It's just a half hour a week, and it's mostly on the internet, but a few stations around the country play it on the radio.
All right, cool. Yeah. Let us know how we can help. You know, we can get you. You know, Charles pumping his book. I'll go on and go woohoo, and you know, I got a long list of. You know, bathroom and cell numbers for just about everybody over the years. So you want to get a hold of somebody, let me know.
I will. I'm glad we're back in touch.
Well, we were never out. You could always call me. Haven't we sent you emails asking for you to participate in our magazine?
Yes, and I did last time.
Okay, yeah, that's right. I remember seeing something. I want to make sure that
Just one email from Donna of asking if you guys could use one of my articles, and I said sure.
Cool. Let me go ahead and I want to pull this up so I can remember.
And my article that you guys used was about my I think it's called Love It or Leave It or Loathe It and Stay and Fight It.
Oh yeah, that's right. I remember now.
Okay. About my struggles with the IRS I'm going through right now.
Yeah, I'm not paying taxes to fund the then kiss it kind of thing. Let me see. Where is it? Cindy. There it is. Okay. Yeah, no, that issue was the war, and I knew we had to have you, so I told her, I said, make sure you get hold of Cindy. Did you see the magazine when it was completed?
I just saw the, is it actually a hard copy?
No, it's a...
Oh, it's just online edition. No, I saw the online edition. Yeah,
you can read it, or you can do the PDF. It's for iPads and stuff. It's tablet.
Oh, okay.
You know, so if you download the file, you know, it's for smartphones and tablets. It reads like a magazine, you know.
Oh, okay.
So we got, you got a tablet, man. It's cool. It's very, very cool.
I have a dumb phone and a computer. That's all I have.
Okay. See, okay, that's what we'll come back with. All right, here we go.
Street. So I ran inside and I grabbed my video camera. As you can imagine, I stood in those bushes for over 20 minutes watching these two degenerates grind against each other, and I'm thinking this behavior is simply unacceptable. Now, if you think this is an isolated incident, you are dead to rights wrong. I have 36 hours of footage to prove it that I have personally collected from sickos just around my own town. For example, I saw perverts having sex in swimming pools, clearly visible from the roofs of adjacent buildings, on boats that anybody could see with a telescope, at night on the beaches where they can easily be watched by anyone hiding behind a fence wearing their night vision goggles. It's simply disgusting.
This is the Onion News Network.
You can sign up to receive the latest about the Liberty Radio Network via our email updates at updates.lrn.fm. That's updates.lrn.fm.
There are those that just want to be left alone, and those that just won't leave them alone. Which one are you? The Ernest Hancock Show.
These trains sounding louder. Ride on the peace train.
Peace train. Anybody on it? Yeah, I think so. You know, that's one thing. It's a cultural shift. And I know Cindy Sheehan has had a lot to do with that. She related to a lot of people that were in the same situation or at least would lend her an ear because they understand, you know, the anguish of mom. I mean, that's it. You know, it's mom. You know, guys get tattoos on their arm and a heart that doesn't say dad, okay? At least not often. So here we have the article that she wrote for the e-zine last month on war. Love, not war. There's a portion in here that says, other people have lost their sons in the wars. What gives her the right to evade her taxes? This is a quote, you know, criticism to them that make of Cindy. So she's having her little IRS battle going on now. We'll talk about it in a little bit. Tax resistance is a moral principle that should be decided by each and every individual. And I would dare to say that most bereaved parents support the wars anyway. For example, even though he opposes the wars, Casey's father has chosen to pay his taxes. That's not my problem or my business. So you're taking as part of your activism, advocating, you know, stop feeding the beast that's devouring your children. So let's talk about that a little bit. You know, tell me, you know, where are you at in the IRS battle?
Well, I have not paid my taxes since Casey was killed, and I've been very upfront about it. Everywhere I go, I talk about tax resistance as a valid and principled and moral form of protest. It's been used very effectively when it's a mass movement for a long, long, long time now. And so after Camp Casey in 2005, 2006, I was highly desired on, you know, college campuses, and I published a book through Simon & Schuster, which I think they just bought so they could suppress it, and but that's another story. And so in 05, 06, I did make reportable income. And but then, of course, I used all the money I made from my book sales or my book advance and my speaking engagements and from Casey. You know, I was Casey's beneficiary. I used all that money to put back into the movement for my travel expenses, for my living expenses, because I wasn't working. So, you know, now the IRS just finally from 05, 06 have caught up with me, and they're, you know, bringing me in for meetings, and, you know, now they're harassing my family even to find out where I am and what assets I have. And since that happened, and since I've been a war tax resister, I don't own anything. You know, the next time the IRS agent comes to my house that I share with my daughter and her family, I'm going to bring him in my bedroom and say, this is my bed, this is my clothes, these are my books. You know, what do you want? What do you want from me? You already took my son. You know, you killed my son in a war that's been proven, that's been based on lies. And, you know, all wars are based on lies or false flag events that are exploited. And our children, the children of the poor and working classes, they go and fight and kill other members of the poor or working classes just for profit. And so I just am like, they took my son, something I can't even place a value on. How can you say, oh, this, my son was worth more than the taxes that you're asking for me? Because that's obvious. It's true. But you can't put a dollar amount on your oldest child. So they already took him, and now they want more from me that I don't have. And so that's one part of why I'm not paying. But the other part is I see what this nation does with the money that people give them. And people always say, well, you know, you have to pay your taxes because, you know, it supports the roads and the schools and blah, 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 whatever.
Yeah, it pays interest.
but that's not the thing. The thing is, I tell people, if Barack Obama came up to you and said, write me a check for $5,000, because I need it to buy, you know, to put towards another Hellfire missile. I need it to, so I can torture one more person in Guantanamo. Would you write him that check?
Some people would. I mean, you know, at least they say they would, but, you know, we'll see. But I think there's a cultural shift towards what you're saying. They're starting to realize that, you know, stop supporting the beast that's devouring us. And I would think that you would get some support from people. I mean, is there any position of support from anywhere on the compass? Is somebody coming to your aid?
Well, you know, there is the National War Tax Resisters Coordinating Committee that they've been in existence for decades since the Vietnam War, and there's a lot of people who have been doing what I'm doing for a long, long time, but they're able to fly under the radar.
I'm not able to fly under the radar anymore. You know, one thing, I want to share this one thing with you before I forget, and 'cause one of the graphics that we have up has you holding the flag and kind of trying. So I would imagine that you got one of those trifolded flags from your son's loss, I would imagine, right?
Yes.
And I was Saturday, my son and I, he's 24, I think, and we went to Michael's, it's just a craft store. They have a frame shop in the back, and I needed some gold leaf for something I wanted to do for my wife for Valentine's project. And as I'm there, they had all these frames and different things and so on. And on the counter, they had one of those framed glass cases for an American flag that's folded in a triangle. And the first thing that came to mind is I go, wow, is there that big a market for that? I mean, that they would advertise it on the front counter of a Michael's craft store that, you know, when for all you people, you know, there's a whole bunch of money to be made framing flags, and gosh darn it, we're cashing in on it. And it caused me pause for a good 10, 15 seconds. I just saw it, and I'm standing there with my son, and I thought of you. And I'm going, you know, this is so sick. And I'm wondering if you're seeing a change in culture to where, you know, war is not glorified anymore. I mean, or they just wait until the sting goes off a little bit and they just start right back up again. I don't know. What do you think's happening in this country?
Well, unfortunately, I see it as a partisan event, and most people who are partisan political hacks, they don't sacrifice their children, so they don't really worry about it that much. But the thing is we who aren't or weren't these, you know, we're the ones that are manipulated or lied to or told that, you know, it's for freedom or democracy. And, you know, Casey didn't go into the military to go kill innocent people. He went in the military because he was transitioning from community college to university. And, you know, we as a working class family with four children, he thought that going into the military would, excuse me, take pressure off the family. So, you know, he could get his college credits. And, you know, little knowing that you know, everybody knows that if you join the military, you might be asked to defend your country or defend your community, but that isn't any really what that happens at all. And so I feel part of my mission or part of what I'm doing is to educate people about that, is to not let what I call the robber class use our children for their profit. And so I think that's why my message is being shut down, because it was effective.
You know, this is the message being shut down. When we come back, I want to talk about the various ways that they shut it down. You know, here we have a Republican presidential candidate up there screaming, just come home. They're trying to shut him down, but maybe a foundation Cindy helped build won't let him.
Uncovering the secrets and exposing the lies. That's what the readers of FreedomsPhoenix.com get every day. FreedomsPhoenix.com, constantly providing the information, the real news about government policies, and the real relationship we all have with the coercive government, the real condition of the economy, innovations in technology, breakthroughs in energy, health, and computer science. Learn the truth well before it's admitted to in the lamestream media. The corporate media, nothing more than distributors of government propaganda, but now there's an alternative.
freedomsphoenix.com. Constant news updates on the issues that affect your life in the most important ways. With liberty and property under constant attack, freedomsphoenix.com provides the understanding behind the propaganda, and it encourages the participation of its readers. Go to freedomsphoenix.com. That's freedoms with an S, phoenix.com. freedomsphoenix.com. The revolution between the ears has already happened.
What if the key to achieving liberty in your lifetime was to move together with others who think like you? Liberty activists are joining the Free State Project, which is over halfway to its goal of 20,000 participants. And they're already making the move to New Hampshire. The successes are piling up and are proving the Free State Project is a real movement and no longer just a great idea. When you're planning your move, consider Keene. Keene is famous for its civil disobedience and non-cooperation, and there's plenty of political opportunity as well. From demonstrations and vigils to outreach and volunteering, there's a lot going on in Keene. Keene is also the undisputed Liberty Media capital of the world, with television, talk radio, and more, all originating here. Though it's more than just activism, with regular social events each week. See what's happening at freekeene.com and get connected with video, audio, free books, a forum, and activist tools you can download and use in your area at freekeene.com. That's freekeene.com.
Are you on any medications? Are you getting your meds at a local pharmacy? If you are, you're likely paying more than you have to. There's a better way. Discount Prescription Services will get you your meds at discounts as high as 70%, and they'll deliver them right to your door. All you have to do is go to meds.freetalklive.com and click Become a Member on the left-hand side of the page. Their customer service is excellent. They will walk you through every step, and you'll save big time. Meds.freetalklive.com.
Instead of just listening, you can also watch. See the Liberty Radio Network's Keene, New Hampshire-based live shows via our studio cam at cam.lrn.fm. Plus, you'll still be able to listen to the Liberty Radio Network via the cam feed in high quality 24/7, even when there's no live show being produced in our Keene studio. But wait, there's more. Our chat room is built into the cam page so you can interact with other listeners online. Listen, watch, and chat. All free at cam.lrn.fm. That's cam.lrn.fm.
You know the Constitution like the back of your hand. You've read books, listened to podcasts, attended lectures, surfed websites, and watched videos. You've made liberty your life's goal, but something seems to be missing.
Stickers from LibertyStickers.com. Exercise your freedom of speech with the world's most dangerous bumper stickers. That's LibertyStickers.com. But wait, there's more. You can buy Liberty stickers wholesale. Get them for 99 cents each when you put 100 or more in your shopping cart in any combination. Sell them or give them away. They're great for gun shows, flea markets, fairs, outreach, and more. Earn extra money, promote freedom, and spread the word. Need custom stickers, labels, or decals for your organization or business? Liberty Stickers makes them. Go to libertystickers.com to order or call 877-873-9600. What's up next? Visit the Liberty Radio Network program guide to find out at shows.lrn.fm. That's shows.lrn.fm.
And now, live from the studios of Freedom's Phoenix, Ernest Hancock.
Vietnam protest, anti-war song kind of cultural thing that entered into the consciousness of the American people, manifested itself in our music. And, you know, and like the Beatles, you know, John Lennon got really involved to the point that he kind of separated from the Beatles and went on his merry way. War is over if you want it kind of thing. All we're saying is give peace a chance. All of this cultural shift is what was the biggest threat to the man. Man don't like threats. They're like, you know, we want to continue this thing. We will. We just need to get rid of the big bad boys out there saying we can't, because yes, we can. And that was the National Defense Authorization Act. When that came out, it was easy to see who that was really targeted at. I mean, they got crosshairs on people like Cindy Sheehan. Professor Francis Boyle, last hour, he was like, because he's international law attorney representing a lot of, you know, the bad guys, you know, the Syria and Libya and, Chechnyans. And just, you know, he's wanting to look, can we do this international law thing? Can we, you know, let's have an argument and see who's the real bad guy here? Who's the aggressor? Who's doing? And in this process, you find that the rule of law doesn't mean anything. You know, the U.S. does. You know, let me tell you what my rule of law is. Rule of my M16. That's what it is. My F-16, my M1 Abrams. So from an historical perspective, from all that's happening now, all that has happened in the past, generation after generation, there's always a new war to save America and defend freedom and, you know, free people from. And it happens all the time. But there's a difference this time. People like Cindy have been out there being chronicled and documented and have a voice that normally, even though they may be shut down by every effort by the media, the mainstream media, the lamestream media, the media so last century, there are other opportunities for them to participate and get their voice heard, like Freedom's Phoenix E-Zine and Freedom's Phoenix and a lot of other sites. So I want to ask you, Cindy, in this last segment, if you could kind of just, you know, give me your perspective on a shift, if any, in the mood, the culture of America and Generation Next that now has access to this alternative news, an alternative source of truth. I mean, just something else other than the regurgitated report by government handout that we get from everywhere else. And is that sustained? Is it going to change? Is there a shift that you see that has a permanent root? I know, what's your perspective?
In that there is a shift that's going to be sustained because, you know, the anti-Vietnam War movement was, you know, large, and it was largely effective. I mean, not enough people give the Vietnamese resistance enough credit for ending that war, but the anti-Vietnam War movement wasn't so much anti-Republican war. You know, it was anti-war. It started really hitting its stride during the Johnson administration. So the thing is we can't let ourselves be co-opted by partisan politics to say that, you know, that I think the anti-war movement during the Bush years was really just an anti-Bush movement because Obama has done things that would have caused, you know, people to
cause Bush, you know, to blush.
take to the streets. You know, people, if McCain were president doing the things that Obama's doing, you know, there would be a much larger outcry than there was.
Okay, now why? Why? Now dissect that. You're in the middle of it.
Because the anti-war movement is mostly populated by Democrats. I mean, Republicans, for the large part, support war. And so, of course, when the Democrat is president, then people say, oh, well, and people tell me Obama knows what he's talking about. Obama's smart. So if Obama's doing something, then there must be a good reason for Obama doing something. Not saying that there's never a good reason to kill innocent people. There's never a good reason to misuse, abuse the resources of a country, our country, to colonize another country.
Okay, let me ask these questions, and you can rapid fire on this. We'll run out of time. Because I'm like, are most people just stupid, uninformed, conditioned, programmed, weak, ignore? I mean, what is it that makes some people very, you know, more aware, you know, certainly, like, I give you the Ron Paul evolution. This generation, next young kids, they got it. These, you don't got to explain, I'm good. You know, I'm wasting my time preaching to the choir there. They got it. They're ambassadors of information on their own. But a lot of, and then you have the older generation, they're just, you know, been from birth to death, they've just been indoctrinated from public school and the media and, you know, watch some more Fox News and plug in and the sheeple. But there are other people that are just kind of, they're unaware, they don't care. Tell me where you see segments of society, where this is going to change. Is it going to change, and how?
Well, we're struggling. The chickens are coming home to roost here in America with this neoliberalism around the world. And so people are starting to struggle, and people are asking those questions, why am I struggling so much? And the Occupy movement, I think their rhetoric was wrong about the 1% and the 99%, because it's not the 1% that keeps us oppressed. It's the 1% and their affiliates who keep us oppressed. And so I would want people to go to my website, CindySheehanSoapbox.com, and I wrote a book in 2009. It's called Myth America, M-Y-T-H America, The 20 Greatest Myths of the Robber Class and the Case for Revolution. So I was on this back in 2009. It's not a partisan political struggle. It's not a gay or straight struggle. It's not a Christian, Jew, or Muslim struggle. It's a class struggle. And it doesn't matter if we're Ron Paul people or if we're in the Green Party or if we're nonpartisan, if we realize that the political system is just there to oppress us, not to help us, that we have to work together to defeat the robber class. And we do this through a real grassroots community building situation. And the 99% of the 99% still don't get it.
No, you know,
this is the situation that we're working with. 99% get their news from Fox or CNN, and they get their news only in like 5 or 10 minute increments every day. So they're thoroughly propagandized still. They see Barack Obama and, you know, et cetera, telling everybody that the economic crisis is over. And they're thinking, well, I still don't have a job, or I'm working 3 jobs, and I'm losing my home or whatever.
Federal Reserve.
What's wrong with me? When it's not their problem.
Get silver, Federal Reserve, ignore the Fed, end the Fed, you know, be done. I'm telling you, I could see where this whole thing is around the banking. I care not who makes the law as long as I get to do the money. I mean, you know,
right.
This is, and more is money, and the health of the state, and all
this
other
right.
stuff.
Absolutely.
Now, on today's archive, you go to Freedoms with an S, freedomsphoenix.com, you go to today's archive, and you'll see in the hour 3, there's all of Cindy's links right there. Cindy Sheehan, soapbox.com, her Facebook page, the radio show. We got a banner link there, Cindy Sheehan Soapbox. Her new book is Myth America. And, you know, interesting title, by the way.
My new book is Revolution, a Love Story, but Myth America was my previous book.
And so you're on the air also. We got links to that for a radio show and so on, the archives and such. So I'm glad you're still there. I'm glad you're going up against the man. That's good, you know, especially IRS thing. But I'm really concerned about the future, and I'm seeing a lot of positive things happening, but it's not in the way a lot of people traditionally think it would be. They are like, well, we got to get the ring of power. We got to be in control. We got to be the ones. We're going to go do it. And that's not really it. It's just we change ourselves. And Cindy Sheehan has been such a large part of a lot of people that normally wouldn't look at this from a different perspective or be inspired by an activist that's actually saying, yeah, you know what, IRS man? Yeah, what else are you going to take from me? You know, you took my son. I don't have anything, so you'll screw you. And this is, so I'm so glad that you're there. And please stay in touch. And we'll keep encouraging you to write for the magazine, because I know you got a lot to say, and you're such a good writer. And I'm glad you're there. Thanks to Cindy Sheehan for coming on, Declare Your Independence with me, Ernest Hancock, and sharing with you. Because this is, you know, this battle is, it's all of us. We all got a part. We all got a voice. Just use it. We'll talk to you tomorrow.
Free Talk Live.
That's it.